everybody, whoever is there, happy Father's Day, and I hope all the fathers are getting spoiled rotten today. Let's have fun with our today's session. So today we have Alnoor Damji, but I call him Alnoor Uncle, and I'll tell you why I call him Alnoor Uncle. As last year we had organized a soccer tournament for the kids, the youths and everybody, and Alnoor Uncle brought his kids over there, and he was trying to have a conversation, and I was talking to one of my colleague Alicia in Kachi, and he goes like, "Oh my God, you speak Kachi? I love you already." I'm born and raised in Dar es Salaam, so I speak Kachi all the time. So I never thought that it would entice him, and that's how it started off, and I started calling him Alnoor Uncle. But I'll give you a little bit of background for regarding Alnoor Uncle. He is, he empowers today's leaders and go-getters to create the career and life they want. He's an authentic storyteller. He's a keynote speaker, and he's a LinkedIn optimizer. He drinks chai. He loves chai, and he likes building community. He's a global goodwill ambassador, and please subscribe his channel at I Am Alnoor, and his YouTube, LinkedIn, Facebook, wherever you find him, you will enjoy listening to his podcast and videos. So let's not take much of the time. Alnoor Uncle, I will head it to you. Here you are. Please start with your presentation for today.
Awesome. Thank you ever so much for the wonderful introduction. It's quite amazing that our youth are doing such a fantastic job in creating these programs and empowering, which is what, and we say we are looking at our future leaders. They are not future leaders, they are leaders of right now. So how did I get started into what I do is that back in at university, I took human resources and industrial relations. It was a great joy to be able to do that, but I was not able to crack into the market. So I was working for a telecom company, and I was going to university then in the evenings after I'd finished my diploma. I got the opportunity to go teach in China. Coming back, I finished my degree and went back to China to teach at the universities there. I got married there, came back here. I have two beautiful boys, so yes, I'm celebrating Father's Day. Thank you so much for that lovely shout out there, Sama, to all the fathers. And from there, I decided that, you know, I really wanted to move into a coaching field after working several years in the human resources profession. I delivered personality dimensions, a temperament-based tool for our Prairies Chamath Council. And from there, I was approached by the health board chair back in 2013 to see if I would be interested in putting mental health into one of my offerings. And I said, wow, that's interesting. So I went to Canadian Mental Health Association in BC, got my training as a cognitive behavior therapy facilitator for workshops. And these are 8-week workshops that we deliver to our Marines, to the multi-faith family members all over Canada. They have been quite successful. And back in 2016, I was appointed as the national lead for the Living Life to the Full program. That's what it's called. I'm happy to say that we will be starting a virtual program next month, piloting it for residents in BC. And in 2019, December 14, after Amula's birthday, I moved into the advisor role for mental health. And so it's just been great. And why I say have chai is because after Kane or, you know, at celebrations, we always have chai and we connect with each other. That's where we can help out each other. So build community, that's very important. And it's just been an amazing journey and to be asked to be doing this. So what is cognitive behavior therapy? So cognitive behavior therapy is referred to as CBT. And it's based on an idea that how we think determines on how we behave. And when we behave in a certain way and what we feel gets this, what we call a circle moving. And in the circle, you see, I've got the emotions, the thoughts, we have the bodily sensations. So with the emotions, what we can do is when we get the certain feeling or the thoughts, now keep in mind, I've got the arrows pointing clockwise, but they could even go, they will go anti-clockwise, and they could start at any one of those points. So say, for example, something happens and you get to feel in a circle, your emotions start to bubble and you think, oh, okay, what is this happening? And from there, it will go into another area of the circle. So our thoughts can get disrupted. We have the perceptions that come across and they contribute to painful feelings. And from the thoughts, it can go to behaviors. And our behaviors will be different than how we would be when we were feeling okay. So keep in mind that this is just a brief overview, idea of what cognitive behavior therapy is. It is quite deeper, but for the purposes of this session, I'm leaving it at just these brief thing, brief introduction pieces. And what are the bodily sensations? They are the changing of our core beliefs that often are the heart of our suffering. So where does this all come into play? Now, take, for example, what is happening right now in the world. With a lot of, with all these news about COVID, our worry chain is what we call it, is that we could be worried that the opening up, I know just before we started, Dr. Case was talking about, you know, massage therapists coming in, and, you know, we're seeing lots more people out and about, restaurants, and, you know, people are not keeping in mind the social distancing, the physical distancing, I do apologize. And we could get that feeling, well, maybe it won't affect, or maybe it will. And now, oh my God, remember what happened during SARS? There could be a second wave. And, you know, just because I had got it and now I'm back at work, I've passed it to everybody and your thoughts start racing. And at times it can feel, oh my gosh, what have I done? I will pass it to everyone. I am the one to blame. And we are imagining the worst possible situations. Now, yes, for some of us, this could be, well, this is just blowing out of proportion. But for others, depending on where we are emotionally, mentally, this could be very much the reality. Now, just given this as an example, let's look at any other trauma that you could have experienced. Maybe a loved one has passed on. Maybe you have lost your job. Maybe some other traumatic events have happened and this chain can start, or the cycle. And what we do, the Japanese have formed this phrase and it says, I can't even pronounce it right. And I'm going to just say what I think it is kachi shabashi. Just like how Saima was saying, like shabash, you're speaking in kachi, so that's what I was calling it. But what this is now I'm going to get you to be really involved and use the check box, if you don't mind, and put down over there if you were behind the yeast shortage all over Canada. So I'll give you a couple moments to go and find out the check box and put down, were you behind the yeast shortage? And I will talk in a few moments. Even let the members of the team jot down in the chat box. Let's see what's going on over here. Excellent, we have one. All right, no you weren't, Dr. Ravji. I think Mum was. Saw her posts. Yeah, but definitely there is a flour shortage. Yes, there was a lot of that going on. And we're going about the toilet paper as well. So where I'm going with this is that the Japanese have created this phrase, and lots of people, if you looked at the Instagram posts, there were lots of people who are baking breads, who are baking all of these yummy things, and we were eating mindlessly. And that is what happens, is you're trying to fill some part of you and you are numbing the pain. And that is what happens many times when we're going through stressful emotions. Now, this is a picture of me back in 1998, sorry. I had ballooned to 360 pounds and you say, oh my gosh, how could that be possible? Well, it started when I was at a young age, when there was a traumatic experience that happened. I was around the age of 5 and 6. And if you think, well, kids don't suffer from traumatic injuries, yes, they do. At age 8, there were even more repeated traumatic injuries that I suffered. And that led to me looking for, you know, some satisfaction or something like that in certain ways. And yes, there was stress. And with stress, the cortisol, and there is the increased feeling of wanting some sweet foods. Because, you know, you take that moment of happiness, and you once you get that high from the sugar spike, and then you go down, and what happens is you want it again. And when you get high and you crash, you have decreased metabolism. And that is what Dr. Ravji was great in pointing out around nutrition and having foods that are good for you. And we go into what's called the emotional eating. Or there could be the times when we're not eating properly, and what we are doing is we're picking up foods that are not healthy. We're picking up items that are easily available in the supermarket, like junk foods. And what do they do is that they promote the idea of wanting more and more of these things. There has been a study, I'm not sure if it's right, maybe Dr. Raji can put this in the chat box, about how Coca-Cola was, when it was first created, the item was in a drug field, and it helps you to get addicted to that caffeine field. And so there are these things that happen when you eat certain foods. So I will be talking about nature, nurture, and nourish in just a moment. So here it is. And where I'm going with this is that this is the roadmap to resilience, where we talk about, you know, how can we look at believing in oneself? Because that is a lot of things that goes on when we're feeling unmotivated, or we have stressed, and we have low levels of depression. We're not noticing our emotions, or when we are noticing these emotions, they're really accentuated. And then we're not able to look at the positivity. We're not able to look at change. We're not connecting with each other. And that is the thing that really does get us to spiral out of control, and we don't do the movement. So where I was going with this, so with the nurture piece, is last week we had Dr. Kenji on. He was explaining the different mechanisms, and he was providing quite a lot of nurturing. And throughout this program, I'd like to even give a shout out to our accountability partners who are here, who are helping us with all of this, right? And what I even wanted to share is that when we are baking in all of that, there is those making those non-katais, right? And I always talk about having non-katais and chai conversations. But if you would like to make those non-katais, this is what I'm going to ask you to do, is that when you give most of the non-katais away as gifts, you're doing something for yourself as well that is going to help you with your mood. Now, this is not part of the movement piece, but I will get to that. I have an elderly neighbor. She's a Jamaican lady, African descent. And you know what I do? I make rotlas, I make sock. And what I do is I go drop it off at her doorstep, and I call her on WhatsApp. I said, open the door. And then we have a conversation from outside, and she gives me a million thanks, and I feel so great about it. So where I'm going with that is, yes, go ahead and do those baking things, but there is limits on those. So now I would like to share a story about an amazing individual. And his name is Shabu. He is a Calgarian. So back in 1999, I'd gone with my family to Cuba. And my older son, he was a toddler. He was just, you know, two years of age. And he was noticing all the other dads playing with the ball on the beach. And he comes to me. I was laying on the, those chairs, those white chairs with the blue towels. And he goes, Papa, Papa, hi, Papa, boy, Ramje. Now, Ubiya Papa Ramita. So I will explain to you, for those that don't speak Kachi, is that he was saying, Papa, let's play with the ball. Look how the other dads were playing. And I said, okay. And I got up and I took a few steps. And I was huffing and panting. And I could not move. And it was that shaming feeling. And where does that shame come from? Is the shame is our past traumas that are coming in, you know, speaking that to us. It's the critical thinking that I'll be sharing in just a few moments. Upon returning to Canada, at that time, my friend Shabu had just returned. He had summited Mount Kilimanjaro. So people are saying, well, there are so many people who do that. And he had done that with his wife, Shahida, and my friend, or Hanif, he's my distant cousin, actually. Now, when they went to the top, as you can see from the picture in the right, it says Team Shabu, Calgary, Alberta, and they had raised $10,000 for Focus Canada. And when he came back, this gentleman, he skis, he mountain bikes, he bakes, he cooks, he plays rasa and dandiya, and he is legally blind. Let that sink in. He is legally blind. And so I you know, asked him the next time I met him, and I said, Shabu, why do you, like, you know, how? And he goes, I believe I can. And I said, oh. He said, I believe I can, so I do it. And so I took that into saying, I believe I can. Whenever I said I couldn't, and I kept on noticing those emotions that were coming up, that guilt that I talked about, that shame. And when we have this thing that's going on with the guilt, are we talking about, it's a good thing to have the guilt to keep it alive with our values. But what happens when it goes over and above? We start in not doing good to ourselves. We start talking of ourselves really poorly. And when I started using, I believe I can, that is self-compassion. And every time I wrote down that on a piece of paper, I can't. And I put the apostrophe and I tore the piece of paper between the N and the T and ripped out the apostrophe. And then I looked at it, I said, I can. When you start doing that over and over, that is positive reinforcement. And you look back to the events back into when the first type of trauma occurred in your life. And you look at that and say to that child or the younger person, yes, you can. I believe in you. And that is how we start changing the script. Now, how many of you here are parents who have busy careers, who are really looking at, you know, empowering yourselves? By the way, talking about water, let me have a sip. Keeping in touch with, you know, family members, and, you know, with all of this thing about staying inside. And we're looking at, you know, staying inside has been really a bad thing. That, you know, when you will reframe that, staying inside, you are sending love because you are loving the world by you keeping the curve down. So when we start reframing, when we start looking at how we can just take a little bit at a time and looking at not into the perfectionism, because let me tell you this, is that when we see all of these things on social media, how everybody's lives are perfect, they're using those filters, and we are not applying those filters to our life to make those pictures look great. So I would like you to think back to the time when you look at where you have said, I need this to be 10 out of 10. And saying 7 out of 10 is okay. 8 out of 10, that's fantastic. Because then you have room to grow. Because once you reach a 10, where do you go from there? And when we keep growing, that's how we better ourselves. And when we start looking at obsessing at our past and also about the future, we are beating ourselves up. Because, you know, the past is there for us to learn for. The future is what we can apply for what is today. And today is the present. So where are you today? How can you look at by taking micro steps each and every day and taking those, if you can't do the exercises at the beginner level, then step it back, scale it back. We will also be talking about movement and have a surprise for you at the end where, you know, won't go much into it. But we will look at where you are at right now and what you can do. If yesterday you couldn't exercise, that's okay. Tomorrow is another day. And be kind to yourself. Because what happens when you start on what's accentuate the positive in trying to do so many things for others, you're not looking after yourself. And there's this phrase, which is like, you can't pour from an empty, I use the word chai, from an empty chai cup. So looking after yourself by walking and looking at it in micro steps, that is where we can start moving forward. So where do I mean by being open to change? We look at chunking. So those that have taken living life to the full, I know there are a couple people over here, and I would like to, they would know what this is. That means breaking it down into smaller, manageable pieces. If you look at, if you remember the previous slide where it was a developer the role who was driving madly down the road, wanting to accomplish everything. And they were, she was like, oh my gosh, I've got to do all of these things. When we are putting everything together, we, and you know, everybody's talking about multitasking. There's no really thing about multitasking. Focus and break it down into small bite-sized chunks. I am a pesca over vegetarian. And when I buy a big pumpkin, I break it down into big, you know, pieces. And there's some parts of it that I'll make into a nice roasted pumpkin soup. Another part I will make into maybe a casserole. Another part I will make into a sock. And I will freeze most of that away because then I can take little bits at a time to be able to do accomplish what I'm doing. The same way, if you're looking at exercise, don't say, I want to climb Kilimanjaro. You can say, well, I would like to climb Kilimanjaro by next year, and I will start working out 3 days a week. I will get the help of somebody who has done that and start looking at some videos, like how these Zoom videos are, the YouTube videos are setting up for you. That is the way we can break it down into smaller bite-sized pieces. And the next thing I'm going to talk about is letting go. Look at this picture on the right, and you can see nature is a great example. It teaches us about letting go. And you look at the different seasons. And you look at fall when the leaves are dropping off, and in the winter, all the tree limbs are bare. And what happens in spring is we see these new leaves. We see growth happening. And that is the thing, is let go of these things that are harming you. Letting go. And how can we let go when we are not even feeling like going to work out when we're feeling low, is by taking one tiny step. So remember I showed my picture of 1998, where I'd reached such a heavy weight, I'd become heavier after that even. And so after I spoke to Shabu, I got myself a good pair of walking shoes. Thank you, Dr. Kimji, for letting us know what shoes are good. And when I put on my shoes, I stepped out of the door. And I was like, okay, Alnoor, just one step. And I took that one micro step and I tried to push one more micro step. And if I couldn't, I said, I congratulated myself. And the next time I did an additional one step. And that's how I moved forward to helping me with these unhelpful thoughts that were coming up. So where do these thoughts come from? We call them negative scripting. As children, we look up to our parents, to our teachers, to our elders, to others, uncles and aunties. That's what we call them. And that's what Saima and so many others, Alicia, and even Dr. Case calls me uncle because he was the camp counselor when my older son was at an overnight camp with him. And what that is that what they may have said to us is our teachers may have said, oh, look at that. That's so stupid. Nowadays, the teachers don't talk that way. But I remember growing up, we were called names and we were beaten, but with a cane, and our parents even beat us, not because they were, didn't, but that is the way we grew up, by hearing all of these things. And we take that inside and we make that larger. So whenever we're not able to accomplish anything, we say even harmful things to ourselves. And if we look at it, we will not say that harmful thing to our best friend. Are we able to look at and looking at ourselves and letting that person who is you sit on the chair and you're sitting beside and pretending you're looking at that friend who is you and saying some nice words to yourself? That's very hard. I know I've been through that journey, and I know that that was very hard. But what is it about change? Is that Robin Sharma, he said, it is hardest at the beginning and it is messiest in the middle. But in the end, that is where you will see great things. And when we are labeling these thoughts, when we are talking about the shoulds, you know, that we're putting ourselves into really should and must that this happens and not looking at all the other factors. So trying to limit these things about and keeping our self-compassion higher up. And, you know, if there are any questions right now, Saima, if you'd like me to answer before I move forward, I'm okay with that. Do let me know.
We have one question here. Maybe you just want to answer that. It says, sorry, joined in a few minutes late. Why does man katai to other people and make them unhealthy instead of fruits and veggies or healthy snacks?
That's a great idea. Thank you so much for sharing that. But where I was going with that is so many of us were baking, myself including, and I couldn't find yeast. So what I was going with that is that, yes, having the rainbow of vegetables, but there are times when you are bored, and when I shared that earlier slide, this is a worldwide phenomenon that everybody was baking. It was not only those in our community, and the Japanese phrase for it is kachi shabashi, which I talked about. And if you're baking, give it, share it with others. And when you're sharing, you're opening, it's all about that. Why do we volunteer? We get intrinsic rewards when we are sharing our food with others who are not able to. We're getting those intrinsic rewards that help us with our mental health. And that's where I was going with that. I hope I've answered your question. And yes, that's a great idea for having the fruits and vegetables. I totally believe in that. I used to love having rooklies, and now I'm very much into rooklies and cutting down a lot on my wheat consumption because the wheat in North America is not that great. So that's where I was going with that. So now let me go into the connection piece. We need connection. Humans need this. Connection helps with mental illness. Remember the times when we were going to Kane? What was we were doing? So many of us were connecting with each other. Yes, we have these Zoom sessions. Yes, we're calling others. We have this FaceTime. But it does not do the same thing. And here is what I'm going to let you know. That yes, back in 1992, 93, I was severely depressed. I used to have lots of panic attacks, and I did seek help. And there is nothing wrong in seeking help. And so we have our institutions who have this access line, the Jamati services, where you call this, and yes, they ask, which geographical region are you in? That way they can provide you with resources that are in your, for example, if you are living in Lethbridge, Alberta, you'll be connected with the Prairies Health Board team if you need it in the health direction. If you were living in Kingston, you'll be connected with the Ontario Jamat. So do call this number. This is a life-saving tool. The other thing about connections, I would like to give a shout out to all the accountability partners who are reaching out and connecting and asking us, how are we doing? Because they are the ones that are keeping us, they are called accountability partners, but what they're doing is they're motivating us. And here's another thing I'm going to ask you to do, is that if you see that there is a neighbor of yours who is also on this, call that person and say, let's walk together in a park, keeping that physical distance. And what I also do is that I put on my headphones and I call my Uncle Kamal. And I talk to him while I'm walking, or I listen to music, but I will come to that in just a moment. When we are connecting with people in that level, we will not notice how far we have walked. It will keep us motivated in going forward. And that has been a real, real lifesaver for me. Okay? So this is a phrase. I do speak in Mandarin now at 2010. And this is a phrase by Lao Zhao. Each journey begins with a single step. And so when we start this journey, take that one single step. And my single step was for asking for help at that time, when I was over actually 380 pounds. I got the help of others in a walking group. I got help with a community who was joining, they have all of these meetup groups where we could go to these walking events. And they were really helpful in helping me, empowering me to take one additional step and helping me when I was beating myself up. So please utilize these tools that are available to you. And they are so helpful. And I said here that I started at the bottom. Now, this is quite a popular song. And now this is much later on in life. And here I am when I'd started hiking. Now, this picture is from last year. Last year, I'd gone back to Camp Chief Hector and I summited the Barrier Lake Mountain. And each and every step, I remember I'd done that 4 years before and I was heavier at that time. This time I was faster, but it was not about the speed. And here's another Mandarin phrase, which was about an old lady that was, whittling away an iron rod, and a kid passed by and he was intrigued, what is this woman doing? And each and every day, he saw her working away on the iron rod. And he said, Grandma, as a respect, what are you doing? She goes, I'm making a needle. He said, well, you're making a needle from an iron rod? She said, yes, son. And the next day he walked by, again, she was doing this. In a few months, that rod has shrunk down to a needle. And so where I'm going with this is that persistence, is that keeping on going, even when it is difficult, by having that understanding, that journey, that yes, we start at the bottom. And love is the bridge between you and that is towards the end. That is the Rumi quote. And when you get there, and now I am here. And so is this it for my journey? No. when we summit mountains, we are then back down at another mountain. And do we think that, yes, we are able to climb this mountain? I feel I'm back at the bottom of a mountain, and this mountain is askew with what's going on with me right now. There is a lot of stress and traumas that are occurring because of COVID and because of so many other things, with the kids not being able to go to school, their homeschooling, making sure that they're being connecting, and all of those. There are lots of things that are going. So this comes to movement. And now I'd like to give another shout out to another lady who was part of Shabu going to the top of the Mount Kilimanjaro. And that's Shahida, his wife. And having a team of those who are encouraging you, I would ask you to please go look at the YouTube. Shabu has a YouTube account, and you see both of them. You Google Shabu and Kilimanjaro, and you will see Shahida helping him, taking his hiking poles and all of those. It's that teamwork. And you see the joy in their faces. I'm getting goosebumps. I'm sorry, guys. It's just such a beautiful thing. And when I talk about movement, and when we do movement, I would like you to take you back. This is a beautiful picture of our Central Asian reeds in during the mulaqat time. How many of us celebrated together? How many of us went and played Dandiya Rasra? What were the songs that were coming on? Salim Suleiman, how many of you can recall that? Now think back to that time. You do, yes, Saima. Please, do put down in the checkbox if you remember with Salim Suleiman. And this is what I'll tell you. One day I was feeling really lethargic. There was so much, it was a gloomy day. And I would say, yes, I have to go and work out. Yes, I have to do all of those things. And it was 5 o'clock before I knew it. And I put on my headphones, and I put on, and I found this Mixcloud link. It was, and they are Ismailis, and it was Azad Radio, and it was the Millennium Mix, where one of the DJs I listened to, and it was the Silk Road. And as I was walking, Salim Suleiman song came on, and it was a dance version. And I was dance walking. And the lights were not working. There was police officers on each side of the traffic lights, and they were directing traffic. And they looked at me, and I'm saying, you know what? I don't care. Next time I'm walking, I'm dancing, you're going to pay me money. But this time, you got a free show. And I kept on once I got going, because I was in such a state of euphoria with the song that was coming on. It transported me back to the mulaqat time. So now I would like you to please jot down in the chat window, how are you feeling right now? So jot down 1 to 5. 1 being meh, meh. 3 being, yeah, okay, you know, yeah, I'm not good, it's okay. And 5 being whoop, whoop, all right? So please jot that down in the chat box. Thank you. Now we're going to do an activity that I was going to be talking about right now. Ready to climb Kilimanjaro, I love that. Awesome. Somebody, you can please put down 1, there's a reason to that. Okay, awesome. All right, Saima, are we ready?
We are, I guess. I think everybody's all hyped up and pumped. So we're going to do a little bit of movement. This movement is, you know, I understand that when you're sitting in the car and you want to move a little bit and groove a little bit, or you have leg pain or anything, and just because your favorite song is up and you can't dance, you can actually dance whilst you're sitting. So we're going to do a little bit of, Zumba today. On this chair. So if you want to stand up, you can definitely stand up. I'm going to show you some moves here, and we're going to go through this. It's going to be on Waka Waka, and I'm just going to pull a little behind, And I'm gonna share a few moves whilst I'm sitting on this chair.
So I'd like to share that while driving down Deerfoot, when Shakira comes on, especially Hips Don't Lie, that's my hashtag too, my hips don't lie, and I'm dancing right there, you know, in the car. So, Salma, get away.
Okay, so I'm gonna demonstrate first the moves, and then we're gonna groove to the music, okay? So we're gonna start this whole song with shaking our hands, okay? And then we're gonna roll back our shoulders, and then we're gonna go right roll, left roll. Roll it back, right roll, left roll. Roll it back, right roll, left roll. And then from that, we're gonna proceed to our next step. We're gonna do a slow jog while sitting here. We're gonna go one, two. One, two, one, two. And then you're gonna pick it up. One, two, one, two, one, two, one, two, one, two. After that, you're gonna put your hand up, pull it down. Left hand up, pull it down. You're gonna open on the right side, pull it inside. Left side, pull it inside, okay? And then you're gonna go faster. Up, down, outwards, inwards, outward, inwards, okay? Once you've got there, then you're gonna go waka waka, our favorite step. And we're gonna go up, up, hands up, okay? Waka waka, up, up, hands up. After that, you're gonna do the last move, that is right leg step out, left leg step out, okay? And then you're gonna go sideways with your right leg. One, two, three, back in. You're gonna go front, front, left leg out. One, two, three, back. Right leg front, left leg front, right leg out. One, two, three, back. Front, front, out, out, out. Okay, now we're gonna do that with the music. I'm gonna show it to you two to three times. So, you know, you get a little bit of hang and, you know, hang out. So give me one few seconds. Like, I'm just going to put the music on. Okay.
Choosing your battle, pick yourself up and dust yourself off and back in the saddle. You're on the front line, everyone's watching. You know it's serious, we're getting closer, this isn't over. The pressure's down, you feel it, you got it all, believe it. When you pull, get up, oh, and if you pull, get up, hey. Cause this is Africa. This time for Africa.
We're gonna redo this again. How are you guys feeling?
Awesome. Olipa, I can't see the moves. They are visible to lots of us over here. I do apologize.
Do you want me to come a little closer for you, Olipa? Or do you want me to stand and do it? Because as I say, you can do it whilst you're standing, but these moves are more for, you know, whilst you're sitting in the car and the music just comes in, you just want to vibe whilst you're driving. You can, you know, shake your body this way, you know, while you're sitting on the red lights and you just want to move your hands and do the waka waka.
So yeah, it's for those that what happens is that if you're not able to walk or if you have leg pain, there are things that you can do to not stop with the movement piece. So remember where I was going with, there are times when some of these exercises, even the beginner ones, could be hard for you. So do some kind of movement. That is the idea behind this.
Okay, I'm going to redo it again because it looks like it was on share screen.
Okay.
Put yourself on large screen and I am going to redo it again. Okay.
Yes.
And we'll do it a couple of times so you guys get a hang of it. And then you can practice it at home, you know, whilst you're sitting and watching TV and all of a sudden Waka Waka comes up and you're like, you know, you want to do it, please feel free. Okay.
So I have an idea for Alibai. If you can go to the top of the Zoom meeting and you can put to a speaker screen, you'll be able to see Saima's moves.
Okay. I'm gonna go back.
Choosing your battles, pick yourself up and dust yourself off and back in the saddle. You're on the front line, everyone's watching. You know it's serious, we're getting closer, this isn't over. The pressure's on, you feel it, you got it all, believe it. When you fall, get up, oh, and if you fall, get up, hey, hey. Cause this is Africa. This time for Africa.
Awesome. That was fantastic. Thank you.
Do you want to go one more time or you guys are okay? How do you feel about this? Just to let you know, this is already recorded for you guys. So if you feel you want to go back to it and look into it, please feel free. It's already there.
Excellent. Are there any questions or would anybody like to do this again? What I'm going to share with this is that the idea behind the movement, especially when we are, say, for example, you are in the kitchen and you're prepping some vegetables or things like that, when you start cooking, is that you go and put some music on. And while you're cooking, you start dancing. While you're cleaning the house, move a little faster. That is how we are going to be keeping our momentum up. Now, I'm just going to go back to the slide documents, and I just have it's the last slide that is now coming up. We do have a question that has come up. Let's. Oh, by the way, how is everybody feeling right now? How many more went up to 5 right now? That were at 4. Can we have a quick count? Awesome, Dr. Case, I see that. So well done, I appreciate Dr. Ravji. Awesome, thank you. So the last part, this is the last slide over here. Just give me a couple moments. It's just, there we go. So this was basically the presentation. Let's open the floor to any questions that we have. I really appreciate the Youth and Sports Board for doing a phenomenal job asking me to be part of this. I can be reached at, I have my LinkedIn address right there. Do you connect with me? It does show a follow, but if you click on the more button or the 3 dots, scroll down and click on personalized invite, you'll be able to connect with me. Those that send me a message that have a basic profile only get 5, so please do not do that because otherwise you have to go into the premium. I do not have a premium account. Let's open the floor to any questions that we have.
Any questions, please feel free. We also have Dr. Jan Mohamed who is a chiropractor. And we also have Dr. Rauji, as we all know, our naturopathic. If you have any questions regarding anything else as well, please feel free to put it up over there. So I have one question here. I think it's for Dr. Jamua, but let's put it up. I'm 71 and arthritis in my knees. The maximum steps I can do is 8,000. Should I aim for more? And then Alnoor Uncle, I have a question for you after that. So let Dr. Janoma do that and then we'll take you over. Are you there, Dr. Jan?
Okay. I don't know. So what I would say with that is if you can do, I think you said 8,000 steps, that's a good start. If you can, always try to do a little bit more. Let your pain be your guide. If you start to get really uncomfortable or you just find that you're really fatigued from that, do take a rest. You don't want to burn yourself out so that you can't do more later. And so, yeah, I would say start there, but do aim for a little bit more if it's possible.
Perfect. Thank you, Dr. Janowit. Alnoor Uncle, we have a question for you. What was the hardest part for you?
The hardest part was seriously when back in 1993, when I could not believe in myself and I was trying so hard. Luckily, I got that help. The other hardest part came when it was beginning the journey. As I said, each journey begins with a single step. And what I talk about is micro steps to massive improvement is by taking one tiny step and having a community of individuals who are there cheering me on. You know, there are times when we have people in our lives that can bring us down. So being mindful of that, and how can you empower yourself? There's so many times we are so hard on ourselves. And that was one of the hardest things for me, was to change that scripting and start to loving myself. Because when you're over 380 pounds, even right now, there are times when I call myself, oh my God, look at you, you're so fat. Or the things that I used to hear were, you're fat and you're stupid. Because at that weight, there are so many things that can happen to you. And then taking that inside. So it was a lot of mental and emotional pain that I had. That was the hardest part for me. Thank you for asking that question. And sorry, there's one more thing I'd like to add here. Is remember I said that, you know, when I went out for that walk and I put that music on, I was feeling very poorly at that day. And at times I feel like I'm in sink mud, that I know I want to go out. The weather was a little bit better at that time. There was still snow on the ground. But what happened is that when you exercise, you do feel better. People used to say, you know, this is when I was heavier, and say, oh no, your body will talk to you when you work out. And I said, okay, work out. And my body said, hey, what are you doing? You want to get us more skilled? So I like to add lots of humor, because I didn't want to work out at that time, go walking. Walking is one of the best exercises that you can do. And if you are in pain, again, as what Dr. K said, let the pain be your indicator. There could be emotional pain as well. But when the music always lifts me up, and it does help with depression, it helps with anxiety, it helps with PTSD, it helps with all these other things. So you're thinking, well, if I exercise, but you're finding it so difficult, that is that catch 22. That is that vicious circle of you not being able to take that first step. So this is a fantastic program of being able, of having a community, of having accountability partners, of those helping you to take that initial step. Thank you.
Perfect, thank you, Alnoor Uncle. I do see a question here. Can you suggest some upbeat music? What we'll do is, we will create a playlist for you guys and we'll add it to the presentation. So you guys can feel free and go through it and look through it if you feel. Me and Alicia will put it up for you guys, okay?
Nice. Based on
our type of upbeat music, because I don't know, what the type of you guys are looking for, but me and Alicia like to listen to, like when we work out and everything, we listen to those kind of music. So we'll put it up for you. I'll go to the next question here. I have a friend who cannot stop eating and has put on a lot of weight. How can she stop? Question mark.
Sorry, my kids are in the background over here. I do apologize for that. That is an excellent question. The thing about change is you cannot change anybody. You can only change yourself. And being kind to that person, because they are going through lots of things over here, stress, is that you starting your own journey, even if you don't have to lose weight, but going for a walk. Because do you know something is that when I was at over 380 pounds and people come and tell me, what are you doing? Are you crazy? Look at all that weight you're putting on. Do you think I was doing it on purpose? No, I could not help myself. And there is a lot of trauma that people are going through. There is so much that is going on in them that we are not sharing. There's so much that people are going through that we are not even open to share. Like as I came and shared about being authentic and being vulnerable, they're in their journey. And so walk each other home is what I love to say. What I mean by that is compassion. Hold hands to hold each other and help them walk home. And that's where that person needs help. But us telling them what to do is going to make them feel even worse. I'm saying this from experience because I know you mean well, but it's not going to be helpful if you do tell them anything.
Perfect. Thank you.
Question. I'm sorry. It's you know, you can start just improving, and when they call you or you reach out to them, oh, I'm just going to go for a walk. You know, I'm doing that because today was such a stressful day. You're giving signals, but you're not directly saying. Or you can say, would you like to go for a drive? And you can sit in the car. Oh, you know, the day is so nice. Let's walk to the bench. And by that, you know what? Oh, this bench is not that. Do you mind if we go for that? Just end up, but never pressuring anybody. And again, this is just a little bit of an idea, but doing it for yourself is one key thing over here. And I see that somebody would like me to invite me to California. I'm on. I'd love to come and do presentations once COVID is over. I also do virtual keynotes and all of that. Hint, hint.
Perfect. Thank you, Alnoor Uncle. Dr. Jan Mohammed wanted to add something to that question as well.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Yeah, just a different lens. What I do with a lot of patients who come in and inquire about like weight loss or just trying to change some habits, I say is before you start to cut out any of the bad habits, like eating junk food or anything like that, is to incorporate some better habits in. So for example, if you're always picking up a bag of chips or a chocolate bar, fine, but eat an apple with it or eat an orange or a piece of fruit. This way, every time you're eating that, you know, chocolate bar, you're also having an apple. And it gets to a point where you're associating the two together to the point where you're actually gonna start craving an apple over the chocolate bar. But like Alnoor was saying here, and we've all heard it, you can take a horse to the well, but you can't force it to drink water. Unless they're actually willing to make that change, they won't.
Perfect. I can add a tiny bit to that. Yeah. There's been a study that shown that what one lady did to lose weight was that when she opened a bag of chips, and that is that micro steps you're talking about instead of changing the habit. So when you break bad habits, that's what I did. I had to learn new habits. And she stopped taking one chip each time she went to the chip bag. Too soon, she was down to just opening the bag and getting that flavor in her fingers. And this is a true story that she was satisfied with just that because she developed a new habit after that. She replaced that. So when we have those bad habits, I love that Dr. Case is picking an apple. Because if you stop cold turkey, it doesn't work for so many people. So that is a great example. Thank you for that.
Perfect. Thank you. I have a question here. How do you deal with swelling in the legs that result in pain or difficulty in walking? I think that's for Dr. Jan Mohammed.
Well, of course, I would say find out what exactly the causes of the swelling in the legs. If we do think that it is from just muscle usage and using like during exercise, of course, one thing you can do to begin with is rest for a little bit. I would elevate your legs so that they're above your heart level. This will help some of that fluid start to drain back. And you can Google or YouTube yoga recovery pose. This is where you basically lay on your ground with your hips at 90 degrees up a wall. And that's a great way to help reduce some of that swelling. If it's specifically in a joint, like the ankle or the knee, you can also use ice.
Perfect. Okay. I do see someone say, amazing session. Thank you, Alnoor, for sharing your journey. It's hard opening up about your personal health journey, but I'm sure quite a few of us got inspired. We have another question here for Dr. Jan Mohammed. My diagnosis is ARPS planovalgus. Recommended footwear NB Fresh Foam, more or Hola One Bondi, both with stiff sole, extra depth rocker. Your thoughts and exercise to improve.
I'm gonna have to read that one to fully get it. I was just kind of listening. Let me just pull up the chat here. Maybe can we? I'll read that. Maybe
we can take it back to the back, yeah. and you'll get this responded. We do have a few questions here for Dr. J as well. We'll take this behind and we'll get Dr. Jan Mohammed to help us out. I do see that there's a question that says, how do you keep the weight off? This might be for Alnoor Uncle as well to answer and Dr. Jan Mohammed. But what we're going to do is we're going to take this off and we'll answer all these questions for you. We'll get your accountability leads to reach out to you with those answers. And we'll also put it up for you in our presentation for them to get it answered. Is there anything else or any other questions that you guys need? Someone says conquer with Rihanna. She was the one who spoke about the amazing session. So I'm assuming that's great. Is that all for today then? Sorry, I just don't want to take much of your time. I do know it's Father's Day. You all have something to do. You want to spoil your fathers and you just need your day off. So we're going to take all the questions, as I say, to the back and we'll let your accountability leads reach out to you with the answers. Please would appreciate if you could leave your email addresses as well, just in case, so we can reach out to you directly. But for time being, thank you so much for today. I hope you guys enjoyed the session. This is recorded. You will find it on the aerobics page that you receive in the email, and you will get all this information. Thank you so much. And we will see you next week. Enjoy your next weekend. Enjoy your this week's workout, and we'll see you next week. Thank you. Take care. Bye-bye.
Great job, Alnoor Uncle.
Thank you. I have a question here. Just a couple of moments here.